I'd like to tell you a story about Albert Di Rienzo, our next speaker. He started his technical career by taking apart an Italian rotating pendulum clock, a gift from his grandfather to his parents. He paid back by maintaining the family cars, repairing home electronics and appliances, and even designing custom motorcycles. Then, for 27 years, he worked at Welch Allyn, Philips Medical Systems, Siemens Medical Systems, Honeywell, Aerospace and General Dynamics. That's a great introduction to medical devices career. Until 2008, Al was Chief Science and Technology Officer at Welch Allyn Medical Devices Company. Since then, he has been appointed the President and CEO of Blue Highway, a subsidiary of Syracuse University, which focuses on science and technology acceleration in the healthcare industry. In his free time, he served on the National Biodefense Science Board, and in 2010, he received a certificate of appreciation from the US Department of Health and Services. He was also awarded twice the Medical Mind Exchange Most Valuable Thought Leader Award by Frost and Sullivan, and as a Technologist of the Year by the Technology Alliance of Central New York. Al serves on numerous academic and industrial boards and is a wonderful friend to have. Welcome, and we can't wait to hear about medical devices in 2025.
Thanks, Renata, I appreciate it. So I'm a little bit worried, though, about that story that Michael gave about the gunshot to the head and some new, my wife might get some ideas from that. I'm a little bit concerned anyhow. So I'm gonna go through this on medical devices. It's gonna be pretty quick. Any one of those can be a full presentation. And Renata told me that I couldn't bring into, bring to bear anything to do with regulatory, political, legal, human factors related things. Otherwise, in 2025, it'd probably look like it does today. So we're going to sort of put all that aside. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what the themes might be, a little bit about sort of different populations, justifications, some consequence, some examples of things that are going on today but are a little bit of a window into the future, some enablers that are helping out, and you've already heard a number of things today, and then we'll take any questions or comments. So, you know, the future devices, they're going to be hybrids. You've already started hearing some things about that, right? They're not just going to be the device. You're going to start talking about more in the way of device and pharma, device and biotech. They're going to be a mixture of different technologies that are brought to bear, different science. They're going to be multi-purpose, multi-use. You know, today you hear about platforms. Everything's a platform. We build on platforms, right? Well, there was one, you know, we've seen a couple of the slides sort of with the little nanobot going through the body. So in the future, it's going to be all, you know, diagnostics, prognostics, but also perhaps a delivery of a therapy or an intervention to mitigate certain health situations. Also, they are going to be multi-use in the sense that they're not just, you know, you see a device, it's just for blood pressure today. It takes your temperature. It's an SpO2 sensor. Again, there's going to be multiple types of technologies or capabilities built into one. They're going to be adaptive and context aware. So devices will adapt to their surroundings, to the particular setting or scenario. They're going to be context aware, much like my colleague Albert over there, he'll be presenting later to talk about context-based vital signs. Vital signs are great, be a lot more powerful if you know what context those vital signs were captured in. And so again, how can you make these devices context aware and adaptive? And you'll see that it's definitely coming. You'll see in some examples. More in the way of ergonomic and interactive. So ergonomics means a lot of things to, different things to different people. But what this is talking about is more from a human factors perspective. So they're gonna be intuitive. The devices will be intuitive, easier to use. They're again gonna be providing valuable information to the clinician or to the patient or to those maybe in some sort of cooperative health work, network. they're going to be green. I personally am opposed to all the number of disposables. We're a capitalistic society, right? That's a great recurring revenue stream. But there's other ways to have that revenue stream coming in besides throwing big chunks of plastic in landfills and so forth. So there's going to be ways to totally get around that. And the new disposable is not going to be a physical piece of equipment. They'll be highly interactive. The devices will interact with one another. They're going to be ubiquitous. We've heard that term used earlier. They're going to be everywhere. These devices will be everywhere. They will be self-sustaining. You know, one of the other presenters talked about batteries. You don't need to worry about batteries. You know, things were sort of powered in a different way. Well, there's technology we'll talk about in a little bit. Certainly things in beta voltaics that will run devices for 40, 50 years. You tailor it to whatever you want. There's also things that are going on in supercapacitors that are actually biodegradable and are green. They're made from tree cellulose that can continue to run these devices for a long time with some pretty heavy power demands. Though minimally and non-invasive, of course, is the theme today, and that trend's going to continue. They'll be unobtrusive. I think Renata used that term later. So these devices, again, will be ubiquitous, and they may be any number of things. It could be an image sensor. It could be a vital sign sort of sensor. It could be some sort of physiologic monitoring or a contextual type sensor. But all this information will be collected unobtrusively, untethered, and brought to bear on different challenges. You know, you hear a lot about open architectures. You really got to drive more towards openness, but the devices will be spontaneously interoperable, and so they will. You can have one company's device communicating with another company's device and being able to share that information without having gigabytes of device drivers that said, oh yeah, you just plug this in, I recognize who you are, and start to work. They'll be private, secure, and incorruptible. I mean, there's been examples in the news lately where people have hacked their own insulin pumps, have hacked their own, defibrillators, implantable defibrillators. So the data, the device, and so forth will need to be incorruptible. From a population and justification, right, whether you're talking about the U.S. or some of the other sort of westernized nations, certainly the goal, and of course even when talking with what we like to do from a world health perspective, we certainly would like to keep people healthier longer, right? Living independently, prediction, prevention, and ensure that you're not getting to that catastrophic event. You're not spending the 80% of your healthcare dollar in the last few months of your life. But again, let's focus on keeping people healthy and productive longer. It's sort of interesting. We always focus on healthcare costs. Healthcare costs in the U.S. last year were 2.4 trillion, something like that. Lost productivity due to those same healthcare costs were three times that dollar amount. So, you know, parents taking children to the doctor, having to take off work, people being sick, not being at work, people who with debilitating diseases that keeps them from work. So it's a big spend here. It's even bigger what it costs the countries. I want to focus on at risk and sort of in this order. So manage or mitigate that risk. The undiagnosed, diagnosed and reduced treatment delay. Managed ill, more interaction and self-management. Put the tools into their hands that's going to give them the knowledge and allow them to help manage that disease and, live a productive life. The unmanaged ill, you need to get to the point where they are managing. And then, of course, end of life, have informed decisions. So the devices, these hybrid types of devices will help to make this these things a possibility. Again, sort of shifting the dollars and the spend and the focus towards the beginning. Consequence, everybody's heard of these, right? You want to have the improved clinical outcomes, clinician, patient satisfaction, quality of care, quality of life, increased workflow. There are so many things done from a technology point of view that do not enhance a clinician's life. they actually put more work into the clinician's existence. And so what can you do to expedite that? Do you need to be in a facility seeing a clinician? The answer is no. You know, lower the cost of healthcare. You think of technology, you think, oh my God, it's going to be adding dollars. It's going to be adding a lot of expense, right? And some of the big capital equipment items certainly can do that. Are we getting the bang for the buck in a lot of those areas? Yet to be seen. But a lot of what I'm talking about, and we'll show you in a little bit, very low cost. So the technology, the cost is trending down, and the capabilities, of course, are moving up. More science and art. I sort of get frustrated that within medicine, there is a lot of art to it, and with what you see coming, there'll be more science and more information that's going to allow the clinician to bring about the diagnosis and truly help their patients be more healthcare managers. I've seen basic sorts of things, being in the medical device industry for a long time, where basic devices, ophthalmoscopes, you would think a pretty traditional device, right? They're used wrong about 60-70% of the time. Basic device, blood pressure, whenever people go get a physical or you take your blood pressure at home, about half the time blood pressure is taken wrong size cuff. They don't take it according to protocol. And so some basic things, a lot of what's gonna happen in the medical device sector will help to fix. It's more towards personalized healthcare. You know, sort of that non-encountered based healthcare. Why do you always have to get in your car, get on the bus, whatever, and get to a building, right? It's like government with promoting economic development. There's always got to be a building behind it. You've always got to go to a building. They'll put the money up for the bricks and mortars, but they won't do it for the rest of the stuff. So how can you make it more non-encounter based, prevention versus treatment, proactive versus reactive? I mean, today, a lot of medicine is truly about, okay, I've got this complaint, I'm at the doctor's office, here's what you need to do to fix that problem. Why do we have to let it get to that point? And it won't. Safer clinician and patient encounters. Again, we heard earlier about medical errors. I mean, that's certainly one of the goals of this, that what's gonna happen in the future with medical devices, it'll happen, help improve that.